All right, welcome back.
I'm glad you're here. I'm glad I'm here too.
How you guys doing today? I hope you're doing well. Hope you got a beautiful sunrise like this. It's a little bit late in the day. And it's coming up earlier and earlier because it's summertime, right? Probably happening by you guys too. I'm not on a different planet, just a different town. We're gonna spend a day in a shop. Probably gonna work on this intake manifold in the Silverado. I think the guy wants it definitely by the end of the week, so we gotta get to it at some point, right? Got a window regulator to do, a couple other things going on. So hang out with me, let's spend a day learning some things and having some fun. Stay tuned.
All right, I'm gonna need to step to get back towards the distributor and stuff. Gotta get that harness out of the way. I think the coil bracket, a couple other things gotta come off of there so I can get to all the bolts. And be careful not to kick this, by the way, because it does a number on your ankle when you kick it. Let's see here, 10 millimeter on almost all of those little brackets and things to get that stuff out of the way. I haven't pulled the fuel lines off. I'll probably do that last because it's going to spill gas.
Some of these bolts are a little tricky to get to, but not too crazy. There's another bolt somewhere in here. This bracket bolts to the back of the head back here, and it's a pain to get to that bolt. But once you pull the nuts off here, you can kind of tweak this bracket up. Use a dipstick tube to hold it up there. You might want to release that a little bit so it won't break. Now, I got the wires off the one side so I can unbolt the cap. I'll leave the other wires connected and just swing it over. I want to see where the rotor's pointed before I unbolt the distributor hold down. Make sure the rotor's where it's pointed so you can mark it and put it back facing the same place. When you're all done, you also have to set the cam retard. You look at on a scan tool and you want to turn the distributor to zero out the cam position because the cam sensor's in what I don't keep calling the distributor, is actually a cam sensor. Two screws. This is the hard one. A friend of mine loves Fords and hates Chevys, solely based on the fact that the distributor's in the back. Hey, it makes you happy, man. It's got a new cap on it and stuff. I do have to take this booster hose off, so I'm gonna have to find a good spot to hold that out of the way. Now what I'll do is, not only do I take note of where this is pointed, but I'll mark it so I don't have to try to remember. And I'll also mark the housing of the distributor. And if I get it perfect, and I probably won't have any cam timing codes. I won't have to adjust it. So I try to get it back where it was. Then I'll look at my data when I'm done on the scan tool. Make sure it shows cam advance and retard, AKA timing. It should be close to zero, so there's a tolerance. Let me get my yellow marker and my needle nose to get that clamp off for the vacuum hose. See that ridge? That faces down. If you look at it, you would think it faces like this, right? All those little ridges do is hold down on the lines. There's also there's a 10 millimeter back here holding that bracket to the manifold. So these are, they'll have enough play that I can pull them out of here. Just want to see if there's any fuel pressure in there.
Residual fuel pressure. Let me get a 10 and an extension to get that bracket loose. I don't want to bend the lines or anything.
Stay, stay. Look at that. I meant for it to do that. Now you can, there's fittings back here to separate this bracket from the main fuel lines, but I find they're a big pain, and if you disturb them, you gotta change the O-rings. So we're not gonna disturb them. I'll just kind of tweak the bracket up out of my way and pull the manifold out from under it. Little bungee cord. We're in business. Oh, I gotta mark the distributor real quick too.
I want to be fairly precise with my marks. It makes my job a little easier down the road, so.
Luckily, because of the way the distributor teeth are, it's driven by the cam. And the teeth, there's only a tooth about every 12 degrees or so, approximation. As far as getting the rotor straight, that'll be easy. Lining the housing up is how you change the cam timing. So I definitely need to make sure my mark's pretty accurate on that. And I'll probably have to make small adjustments to it, but.
This little, gotta do that hold down bolt, and I'll be able to lift the distributor up. As I lift it, the rotor will turn to match the way the teeth are cut on the distributor. So when it turns, I have to watch if it goes left or right,
When I put it back in, I'll start it that way and it'll end up in the right spot. I'll show you.
Well, that wasn't very, very tight. That's all right, though. It wasn't loose either. It was just, I'd probably go a little bit tighter, that's all. Now, if you're really sneaky, the distributor hold down has a slot in it. You just pull it back.
And it'll let you get the housing past it.
Let's see how long this has been in here now. There it is. See, the distributor's turning counterclockwise towards the driver's seat. So when I put it back together, I'm gonna put it there when I drop it down, and we'll be golden. Can't just go ripping it off of there with, was it 30 years worth of trash trapped between the manifold and the valve cover, so. Rags in the throttle body, I did that last night, because you never know what kind of critter might try to go down there or if it rains. EGR is a 22 millimeter, by the way. I think I mentioned that yesterday, just in case. And there's a little bracket on the back of it. There's only 8 bolts holding this manifold in, much easier than the last generation. There's 2 bolts around each coolant passage. I did drain the coolant, but it'll probably still spill a little into the crankcase. So you always have to change the oil after you do this too. Even if you just changed it, sadly, you still need to change it after this repair. You too, come on, let's go. This is the bolt I had to loosen the bracket for. Now if there was a notch right here, you wouldn't have to do it, but this ear kind of comes over, so anyway, so it kind of helps to just pull it out of there, loosen it up, whatever. They don't even make this engine anymore, sadly. This was 1955 to, I believe, 99, 2000, something like that. They started phasing them out, and they went to the LS platform. These are great engines. Their weakness was the sheet metal valve covers and things like that would leak oil, and put new gaskets on, they wouldn't leak for a year or two, and they'd start leaking again. Where the LSs are cast valve covers with O-rings, all that kind of stuff. It's actually started by Japanese manufacturers. And Americans said, oh man, those don't leak a lot longer, and people seem to like that. But they started doing it. Anywho, let's see if we can lift this off of here. Got to get a pry bar of some sort, find a couple good spots to break the seal, and then it should lift out. I think I'm going to have to lift it out kind of like this. I'll bring it to the side forward. So we'll make sure all our goodies are out of the way. Put this out of there. That'll give me some more room. Feels like some decent holding it. Never force. Give it a little love. Doesn't want to come loose in the back where the leak is, actually. Looks like it's hanging up on the valve cover, which is odd. Usually I can get it to pop up. The ridge of the valve cover is catching on the edges, so I gotta take at least one valve cover off, maybe both. I normally don't have to, but I'm not gonna force it. I can see the valve cover flex when I lift up on it, so. We're in valve cover removal mode, and I think this is the easier one to get off of there. There, get out of there, valve cover. I could take the valve cover completely out, but I don't want to let dirt fall in there. So I'm just trying to sneak it past when I get the intake back on, then I'll do the valve cover gasket separate. Trust me, fits out of there. There you go. Yeah. Someone has gone hog wild with the silicone. All right. My job is going to be to clean this mess up and get as little debris down in the motor as possible. Usually I'll just lay some rags across the valley, 2 or 3 overlapping, and I'll catch 95% of the debris. Try to scoop out what I can, and we'll change the oil afterwards. I'll actually run, like I'll find a partially used container of oil. After I pull the rags and debris out, I'll run some oil over everything, and then I'll change the oil after that. All right, I got my rags in place. Now it's safe to remove the what's left of the intake gasket. Quite a bit of a mess in here, silicone, but gotta get a gasket scraper. This is a place where everybody likes to kind of use a Rulok disc, but try and avoid that temptation. Scrape it by hand, get it clean so you don't feel debris on the surface with your finger. It doesn't have to look new. It has to feel smooth and the gasket will seal. So that's what we're gonna do next. First,
you want me to?
I gotta do the Kia exhaust apparently is here. So this one's not a big rush. I'm gonna check that a little closely for corrosion and then we'll see if we need to replace it or not. I'll show you that.
All right, this is where it was leaking coolant. You can see the gasket's totally blown out and there's no corrosion. So it's in good shape. I cleaned it about 80-90% of the way. There's a couple little, you can feel these just a little bit. You basically want it all to look like this. If you look at the finish, you can see it actually has a little shine to it. And you can see the machining marks. It's actually measured in microns, how deep the scratches are. So if you put a Scotch-Lock pad on that and sand it, I think it looks beautiful. Not only are you making divots and waves because you can't machine it the way they did, but you're making scratches that are too deep and it's a leak path. Every little scratch is a potential leak. So I'll keep cleaning this up. I'm gonna probably get my carbide scraper and just get some of this a little smoother so it all looks about like this and this here, and it'll be good. Same thing on the engine. It's a little messier in here. I've gone over it once with I spray brake clean on a rag, wipe everything down, get the heavy stuff off. Then I can go over with my carbon scraper. I could be a little more aggressive because this is cast iron. So this is pre-aluminum heads and block. So clean that up nice. You could probably use a Scotch-Lock on it, but I just avoid those things. I don't like them. I would only use it if there was something real nasty. I wasn't sure if it was corrosion or something in a little spot or something like that. But carbon scraper and some patience. Get it nice and smooth. And you're ready to go back together. Let's get on that exhaust. Let them know this intake's okay.
You might say to yourself, Jimmy, that doesn't look like exhaust work.
That's because the regulator came in for the escape. It's in my bay already. Should only take 20, 30 minutes if the world is spinning in the correct direction and stuff. So we'll see if we can align all the planets and knock this thing out real quick. Like I said yesterday, the glass doesn't look cracked looking down in here. We'll know once we get the door panel off though, won't we? Hopefully that's okay. We'll just pop a regulator in and be done. So it's going to be Phillips screws, and there's some hidden under here probably. I'll have to pop this off. Let me get my trim tool. And, I got some screws and stuff hidden up here. Let's do it. Trim stick on the way.
There's a Phillips screw in there. Good thing I took a look. It's out. I'll have to pop these out while we're at it. A lot of these Fords have door panels on hooks. They'll just lift up and pull out, but we'll know in a second, I guess.
Get back here.
Screws on quick.
Nice.
That wasn't gonna fall out, I guarantee you that. Let's take a look under here, too. I try to always pry from someplace you're not gonna see looking at. One big Torx. Instead of a Phillips, they said, hey, you're gonna have to go back to your toolbox and get a Torx. What's that, like a 27? Something like that? I got a 30 because it just looked right in my cart staring at it. There's no close inside of it. Sometimes the wrong size will work, but you gotta be careful. Usually if it has any play at all, it's too small.
Hey, Joseph, I need to know if that master switch has auto down, auto up on both front or just the left front.
I don't like braking stuff. This thing's got push pins, not lift hooks.
Okay.
You can see down in here, I can see some push pins. Start from the bottom in case we do a little damage. That's what I was unplugging here. Door lock switch connector. Cable that just drops in and you turn it, snap it into the door panel. Nice and easy. It's unusual that they have snap clips though. Must be something Mazda had a hand in.
Oh, here you go.
to get this water shield off. You gotta do a little bit of plastic retainer removal. You gotta take off this bolt, and it looks like I'll have to take the speaker off. You can't cut these with a razor blade, but I don't even know which hole I'm searching for. No, I'm just gonna try to take it off in one piece and not cut it if I can. I think I gotta get 5.5 for the speaker. Well, 5.5 didn't work, so hopefully it's 6 millimeter. Yep. Ford said, you know what? We're tired of 5.5s. We're going to 6. 5.5's just not getting the job done. A mechanic designed this, it would have Phillips like the rest of the screws. You wouldn't have to go get another tool. But obviously mechanics don't design stuff. They only fix it and deal with the problems created by the engineers. And the engineers, in their YouTube videos, they'll be talking about how mechanics complain too much. That's just how it is. Just accept it and deal with it and move on. That's all. This is going to peel off fairly good, which I like. That's when you get a peek at the glass. Yeah, that's not broken. Nice. Come back, we'll be unbolting this thing. Got to line up these bolts with the holes. You do attempt something like this yourself. In case you haven't seen my other regulator videos, all of the metal in here is like razor blades. I shouldn't say all. Where it's curved here is great, but you won't cut yourself on that. But wherever it's flat, you do not want to drag your hand along it. You can grab it, pull it, just don't slide your hand up and down it and cut yourself. It's very sharp. So, if I slide this window up, I should be able to get my little security bag in here to hold it out of my way while I work. I have to take this weather stripping off. This should pop up. No big deal. Put my diaphragm in there. Not birth control, just to hold the window up. And as soon as I see the door start to expand, I know I'm good. It won't hurt the glass. It's just pushing the metal just a little bit. That's when you know to stop. Now the regulator should come out. 2 tens, 3 tens on the motor. And we should be able to lift it out of there. Sometimes the regulators come with motors, sometimes they don't. So, but I believe this one sandwiches everything together anyway. So if it doesn't, whether it comes with it or not, you probably have to take it all out. How tiny that motor is, my goodness gracious. It's the size of a radio controlled car motor. All right, let's see if the new one's right. All right, make sure it's looking good. Take note that the motor's part of the regulator, doesn't separate. The original one, these screws aren't even in there. There's no option to take it out. Made in Taiwan. It's got an adapter connector, which should be fine. You can turn it inside the door. Even the regulator has razor blade edges on it. You can grab it, like I said, don't pull your hand on it. If it hooks on something and you're lifting, it's going to cut your fingers up. So I'll either use a rag or I'll be very careful. I've done enough other than that. I'm usually just careful. Once in a while, I cut myself. Especially if I talk about it a lot while making a video. That's when it's more likely to finding that little stud is going to be a challenge. So I'll get it close and line up the bottom one. There it is. Put my nuts on so it doesn't fall back out before I play with the motor. I'm not going to tighten them up yet though. Now these holes make it so you can put the screw in first, but you don't have to. You can line it up afterwards. I can see where the threads are. So. Okay,
I've done the math correctly, the bolt holes will line up with the glass. So now I just got to drop the glass on it, put those bolts in. Probably shouldn't say drop the glass on it. That's probably not the correct, see what I mean? That's why you don't say drop when you're handling glass. It's pretty durable, really. It only breaks if it takes a serious jolt. There's plastic shoulders on these things so that it will sit where it, about where it's supposed to go. This one's a little harder to get to. I'll try to feed it in with a socket.
It's all back together. Now the exciting part is to see if it works. So let's go around there, flip that key on and try it.
Might as well start it up, get the AC going.
Look at that son of a gun. Is that amazing? It works. Unlike the starter Joe just put in that Honda. Bad starter right out of the box. Oh well, that's terrible news. If you didn't see yesterday, 57,900 original miles. You guys remember this one, right? Supposed to be doing some cats. Let's see what we got for parts, though, because I don't know if things went the way I expected. One cat's an exhaust manifold, I believe, and one's a secondary cat. So let's see what we got right from Kia, too, I think.
Some of you guys might remember.
The front cat came apart, which is the exhaust manifold cat. And then there's a secondary cat here, and it's full of debris. And I loosen this up, it runs good. So all the debris is here, and that cat's empty. But they only got me this cat, which I told them, get me this one. And I could probably empty that out and reuse it. But the best thing is to replace both. But we only got the one that's holding all the debris. Which I could pop this in, no problem. It'll run great. But it's gonna set cat codes. So let me run that by them real quick and then we'll see what's gonna happen. I'm guessing I'll put this in and they may have to order the front one and have them come back or something, I'm not sure. One way to find out is to stop talking about it and go see.
They said Kia said it doesn't have a front cat. Okay, I lifted it up. It's right there. The Kia said doesn't have one. Okay. Like a well-oiled machine. Nothing but 100% efficiency. Let not your heart be troubled. Carry on with your mission. Well, I got the garbage can under here because there's going to be some debris coming out of there. It's not supposed to be like that. This cat's definitely damaged too. That's what it's supposed to look like in there. See the honeycomb? That's nice. I like the cereal. Just the shape. This is gonna go. Okay, I guess it'll work.
Jimmy, go ahead and do the lower cat only. Lower cat only.
You got it, boss. Lower cat only. You got it. You got it. It was already underway. You gotta clean the threads up on this bolt. It came off with a little more gusto. Ran his tap through. I wanna say it's a 12 by 125, but clean the threads up nice. So we don't wanna hurt the new cat. Things are quite a bit nicer than the other one now. Torque spec on these, I think, is about 2 ugga-duggas. That might have been 3 on that one, because it spins so nice. Alright, this car's fixed. Well, as fixed as I'm allowed to fix it.
You might remember last week I fixed a misfire, which is what probably smoked the cat in the first place. So we're gonna get cat codes. They're aware of that. Apparently, at least I told them. I didn't tell the customer directly, but I told them up front to tell the customer. Key fob's giving up the ghost. Oh man. So the two things we'll accomplish is it's quiet and it'll make good power now. But two or three trips, cat code PO420, bank one, cat efficiency. So, but at least they'll be able to drive it and it'll be quiet. Won't sound like a Fast and Furious car. I think I'll be back on the Silverado after I road test this and make sure everything runs good and burn all these storage. There's like oil on these cats. You gotta burn that off. Plus it actually activates glue and stuff in there when the cat gets heat cycled. So you wanna definitely get it nice and hot, then let it cool completely before you give it to the customer. That's the best way to do it. Sometimes you don't have that option, but it's called bedding in or breaking in the catalytic converter. So you should always try to do that. I'm gonna go drive that, see what's next. I know I'm not doing this one. Metal to metal. Got rotors. That means the oil change guys will do it. Oh, fancy gasket set. Comes with bolts and everything. Look at all this. Comes with new manifold bolts, the whole nine yards. These Chinese kids are making good stuff nowadays, see? Didn't believe me, did you? These are actually the really good gaskets. These little dimples, they go in the cylinder head. Sometimes a lot of people will make the mistake of not clearing out those holes. They're right here. You gotta make sure they're all cleared out. Make sure these threads are nice and clean. The bolts pass through, which there's sealant on here so that they won't leak, but if I was reusing the old bolts, I'd clean them up very good and just put a little silicone on each one of the bolts so that it will seal. Because this goes into an oil passage, they could seep a little oil. They normally don't, but it's possible, so why take the risk? So what I'm gonna do now is put some silicone in each corner, put the gaskets in place, and then run a bead all the way across on top of the gasket. So the silicone under the gasket and over. Otherwise it could leak in the joint. If you only put silicone on the top of the gasket, they may not squish through to the bottom. It'll be a leak path. So this is all cleaned up really good. I used my carbon scraper. Got everything you can feel off of it, so it's smooth to the touch. It may not look too pretty, but it's perfect. Trust me. A little bit of pitting in the block here. Nothing big. That's going to get a quarter inch bead of silicone. I try to get the manifold in place without wiping it off the back especially, and then drop it down on the gaskets. Should be easy, right? Manifold's cleaned up just the same way. Use the carbon scraper. Smooth to the touch, even if it doesn't look that pretty. I've got about an hour worth of cleaning everything and trying not to drop debris in the motor. I pulled all the rags out of there and rolled them up carefully and not let everything dump down. Enough talking about it. Let's get the tube of silicone, get those gaskets in place, and get started.
These metal ones, way more durable than those plastic ones, so make sure everything's in place good. There's no difference left and right for the old silicone bead. I'm gonna use this little tool to roll the silicone out. It makes it a little more even. Most modern engines, you don't want to use this much. Like these old Chevy small blocks, they like it. We don't want to leak, especially back here. Engine tilts back, it tends, if it's going to leak oil, it'll tend to leak out the back, but nothing left but dropping the manifold on there now. You don't have to put silicone around any of these coolant ports. Matter of fact, if you put silicone on it, it could make it leak rather than stopping the leak. I'm going to leave this valve cover off because it was a little bit of a bear to get it out. I'm going to have to kind of put it in and tilt it under here. I pulled this forward a little more too. Not too pretty of a thing, but it works. Now what I'll probably do is snug these up and get that valve cover back on so it's not sitting open too long. Then we'll start the torquing process. It's a little bit of a reach back there. I need like a ratcheting mechanism to make my arms longer temporarily. That would be great. This gasket just stretches and sits in place. If you bump it into something, it unsits in place. You gotta try not to do that. Not easy though. A little bit of a battle with the bolts getting just in between the rockers. So you gotta kind of slide it into place.
You got it all a little the stands for the bolts so you don't crush the valve cover. And the stands are wider than the rockers, so you got to kind of hook them in between the rockers. Not so bad after you figure that out. You don't crank this down ridiculous tight. As soon as you see the pipe start to flex, you're good.
That's back up.
Got my new gasket on there. Take note that this has a slight crack where the screws go, but it's expensive, so we're gonna try to rock it, see what happens with it. Now remember, it turns from facing number one cylinder, right? I can plug this in, make it a little easier than doing it after. Now that should turn and line up as you go down. Boom. You can get the clamp over it, it's in. Got my marks lined up, rotors lined up. I'm gonna tighten this little 13 on the hold down clamp. And now we'll put the cap on next. Hold down clamp is snugged up. Now those usually break from using power tools if you're not careful. So I'm gonna use power tools and be careful. A little disconcerting that the wires are tugging so much. Gently. Once you feel it snug, you're done. It only goes in that plastic where it's already cracked, so we don't want to replace it. We have to make it work. That's something that I hear a lot lately now. You really need that? Can't you make it work? I know. You got a YouTube channel, man. Make it work. I'm going to put this bolt in this EGR bracket while I'm back here before I forget about it. After that, whatever happened. It's remotely possible. Got to bolt in the fuel line. I'll put my flange on here next. Whew, that was fun. And now I just gotta climb back out. Yeah. All right. Next, fuel line clamp, as I mentioned, with the flanges facing down. Well, that was interesting. I went to put the wires on the cap, and the wires were hitting the bracket that holds the harness. So I put it back where it was, but it looks like they must have had the wire being pushed very hard by the bracket. So I would have had to force the wire on, and I didn't want to put it back the wrong way. It looked like it was clocked wrong, because if they put it in a tooth off, you can just turn the distributor enough to make up for it, right? So I went a tooth the other way and made sure I lined it up with the mark on the housing, disregarded the mark on the intake. That's going to bring the cap with it. It's not going to affect the timing. I'm probably going to have to adjust for zero, but at least now it'll be clocked correctly and the wires should all clear. Had to call do-over. That's one of the beauties of working on some of these older vehicles is you end up having to fix things someone else did. Half the time things weren't done correctly, and it's been worked on quite frequently when it's older. See, now the wires are straight and they don't want to be. It wants to be turned. So now I have to readjust the wires in the loom so I can clock it correctly. I was wondering why it was so hard for me to get the cap to line up earlier and these wires were fighting me. Just make some adjustments. And these normally are pretty straight on here. And now it'll be straight again. We're close to it. Get this bracket on here. Customer with the Porsche is back. Remember, I don't know if you remember the other day, he tried to force us to work on it right away. The headlight slides in and connects here. And you have to adjust this to lock it in place. See how that turns and this goes with it. But we put a bulb in it, but this wasn't locked in place, so I'm thinking it was just jiggling. I tapped on and it turned on, but I'm gonna look inside at the socket and see what that looks like. And take this cover apart. There it goes. Ooh, look at all that going on in there. That's, what could go wrong? Well, pulled it out to inspect it, and if you can see that, if it comes up, it's kind of dark in there, but the harness is crumbling. So, it's gonna need headlights. The only way to get those harnesses is to get headlights. All right, let me let them know. We'll see what happens with this one.
Aha! Get you guys caught up between the Porsche fiasco. The customer with the Porsche is a nice guy, but he is a real pain in the patootie. And he wants you to drop what you're doing and do it right away. His appointment actually was for tomorrow. But he wanted to come in today. So we stopped what we were doing and helped him out. But anyway, I gotta put this fitting in. See the Dorman flag of death on there?
It looks like it will work.
It's like a 26 millimeter wrench or 25 millimeter wrench. Maybe a socket to get it out of there. It's a pipe thread on the bottom, quick connect on top. Little clean antifreeze on the O-ring. Good to go. 27 millimeter fits this one. Hopefully it fits the old one, if it fits the new one. Got some fresh new sealant on the thread, the new part. If I had it before, I would have put it in while the manifold was off. But, you know, yeah, we're getting close now. This is pipe thread, so the tighter it gets, the tighter it gets. Pretty good. I already oiled up the fitting. Back in the plastic clip. Let me do the oil real quick. I'm gonna fire it up before I put coolant in it. Just run it for a few seconds, see how it runs. Just in case, you never know.
Let's go in here and give the old girl some love. Some ignition love. Oh, come on, man, that's nice. It's like a brand new 245,000 mile truck. Let's go ahead and get some coolant in this thing so we can run a little longer. I'll put the scanner on it too. I still gotta make sure that cam sensor is zeroed. Usually if it's not though, bing, the check engine light pops on. So we might be in good shape.
Putting this together, I noticed the lug nuts aren't right for the wheels. All the way around, he's got the wide taper seat, but the wheels have the narrow taper seat. So I'm gonna let him know. Obviously we'll make a note. And he also took a grinder to the calipers to get the wheels to stop rubbing. That's kind of sketchy. So basically the wheels are wrong for the truck. They look cool though. You guys know how I feel about that stuff. I apologize. I don't mean to act like an old crank, but I'm old. I'm not really that cranky though. I just think it's funny more than anything. Get this coolant topped up. These are really good about self-bleeding. I find you don't have to use the vacuum fill system or a funnel or anything. They're pretty forgiving. But I'm gonna fire it up, make sure some air percolates out of this thing, and we'll top it up a little bit. 50-50 coolant and water. This isn't pre-diluted, so you have to dilute it yourself. I'm gonna go fire this thing up. Let this thing run a few minutes. Double check the coolant level. Take it for a drive. Okay, on this Silverado, I'll show you guys what I'm talking about on the cam retard. It's supposed to be zero or within 5 degrees of zero. So technically it's good, but I'm gonna try to get it to zero or really close, under a degree. To do that, you rotate the distributor counterclockwise and it will add, and you rotate it clockwise, it will be less. So the distributor rotates this way. So if you turn it with rotation, it'll take away retard. Because right now it thinks it's 4 degrees too far advanced, right? Gotta be about over 1,000 RPM. It's got some play in the timing chain too. That's what all that movement is. It's normal to have some movement, but it seems to be moving quite a bit. Turning the distributor and the wires are touching the bracket on the other side now. So my options are, I got two options. Leave it at 4 degrees or take the distributor back out and move it a tooth back. I went two teeth, I probably should have went one. But I'm gonna live at 4 degrees. It's within 5 degrees, it's supposed to be close to zero. It's not setting a code. I'm gonna go and drive it, make sure it runs good, make sure it doesn't set a code. Worst case scenario, tomorrow I'll be moving it back a tooth. We'll see what happens. I hope I don't have to do that. That distributor is, it's not gonna live through removing that cap again. Otherwise I'd do it without question. I already had to go to a one size bigger screw to get the cap to tighten up on top of the distributor, cam sensor, whatever you want to call it, but they don't want to put one in it. They don't have any more money. And I don't want to make it so they don't have a choice. So we're going to have to live with that. 4.1. I'm going to take it. I'm going to run. I'm going to run towards the end of the day. We're almost there. I got to clean up all these tools, my scanner,
and see if there's something else we can do. We don't have much time left in the day, but we might be able to squeeze something else in. Don't give up yet. All right, guys, as it turns out, there wasn't anything else I could do like I was hoping. I wanted to do something quick and easy, but instead I cut this out and started fitting it to the shifter so that I can just not worry about it anymore and get the floor done. I know it'll bolt on. I'm going to weld a plate over this so that it will just come around there and I can put a boot on. I have a boot kit for it already, so I just got to get a little more height in the back, put a flat metal plate on it, and I can bolt the boot to that. I know you guys aren't here for project truck videos. I apologize. I know your time's valuable. Thanks for spending it with me today. It's been my pleasure. I hope I see you in the next one, because you're awesome.